concerned about copying. Romans, copying, Greeks. David Hockney and the camera obscura, as Jamie just pointed out. Thomas Aikens and the camera, that was a secret for years and years because of the anxieties about... The anxieties about photography. And it was so interesting, Jane, when you, I did not realize that you had purchased that material later. I thought that that had come sort of wholesale at some point. So the fact that that had been, you know, somehow quiet, even suppressed early. And Diana Korzenek's exact words when she was talking to us as Grandma Moses said, would you like to see my art secrets? So it was even, you know, this kind of slightly, you know, slightly inappropriate.
Well, let me, what, you know, maybe some of the other panelists want to talk about this in a more general sense. In terms of Grandma Moses and, in general, self-taught artists, there was, and to some extent still is, a prevalent myth about the self-taught artist, the naive artist, the primitive artist, the outsider artist. And that myth is that these artists are completely uninfluenced. They are the counter to the academy. They aren't taught. And so the myth goes, not only didn't they go to school, but they never looked at art at all. They don't know anything about art. This just all sort of dropped upon them from the heavens, which, if you think about it, is complete nonsense, because no one lives in an image-free environment. And artists, above all other people, are sensitive to whatever images there were in their environments. But this was something that was repeated over and over again, and sort of the foundation myth, if you will, of naive or self-taught art, both in Europe and in the United States. And it was only, you know, within the last few decades, for example, that the printed sources used by Edward Hicks began to be researched and revealed. So being just familiarity with any kind of pre-existing imagery was sort of the kiss of death for a self-taught artist. And John Kane, who was the first self-taught painter to come to the attention of the art establishment in the United States, began his career by painting over photographs for people. He would go door to door. He would say, you know, do you have a family member or a loved one alive or deceased that you would like to have memorialized in paint? Give me a photograph. He would have the photograph enlarged, and then he would overpaint it. And after he was discovered, it was like a sensation. It was the first time anything like this had been had ever happened in the United States. His work was admitted to the Carnegie International Exhibition. All these trained artists who had been trying to get in for years and been rejected were furious. And one of the Pittsburgh newspapers bought a John Kane painting, and they took turpentine and they cleaned off half of it, and lo and behold, underneath the painting, there was a photograph. And this was a disgrace. So there's a long, long, long history of this, and many reasons that Grandma Moses knew implicitly, if she wasn't explicitly told, that she must not talk about this to anyone.
Yeah, and just one of the things that happened after John Kane, after that was discovered by one of the Pittsburgh newspapers, was they brought in some of his paintings to x-ray them. And to show, and they published pictures in the newspaper to show that when you x-rayed his landscapes, those didn't have photographs underneath. And so there was this kind of like you know, reckoning and vindication moment that followed in the press of trying to clear his name and show that he actually painted his landscapes, you know, without photographic reference. But I think that more generally, going back to what you said at the beginning, Tom, about the T-shape of modernism and modernity, modernism being the kind of trajectory of art, you know, after Manet, and then modernity being the changes in society that happen with industrialization in the 20th century and that sort of thing. These two things converge. And so you have with modernism the kind of throwing out of the kind of criteria that you normally use to judge art, right? The academic criteria of the different genres of painting and which are the most esteemed in the academy and how good this painter is at capturing you know, realism and figure and modeling and this sort of thing. So that goes away. So that's not the criteria for judging good art anymore with the kind of revelations of modernism. And you also have modernity bringing in new technology like photography and, you know, the mass production of imagery that creates these kinds of sources that artists can use. And so these things kind of converge to create a crisis where artists are using these new technologies of modernity. And then modernism has brought a kind of total overthrow of former artistic standards. And there's just a real discomfort, and people don't know what's allowed, essentially. You know, how to judge good art becomes, you know, as you've heard today, very much a matter of opinion and tied to people's own kind of programs and subjectivities. And the fact that artists are using all these new kinds of tools and sources just creates, I think, a lot of discomfort, amidst a discomfort that's already brewing over what is good art.
I think that was brilliantly put, because the sort of the bright line of kitsch, what is kitsch, moves so quickly between the 1890s and the period we're talking about. Chromolithography in the mid-19th century was taken to be democratic and positive and would somehow you know, provide a visual understanding for the masses, and by the turn of the century, it, of course, is kitsch. It's something you put in a beer hall. So that kind of constant shift in photography plays such a huge, huge role in that. Jamie, have you thought about copying?
Well, I'm going to use an anecdote. I'm trying to remember the exact narrative, but I'm paraphrasing here. So Grandma Moses met Norman Rockwell. Norman Rockwell lived in Arlington, Vermont, not far from Eagle Bridge between 1939 and 1953. As I mentioned briefly in my talk, he decorated a cake for one of Grandma Moses' birthdays. And I think in a very real way, one could find parallels between Rockwell's process and Grandma Moses' process. He would construct his images from photographs. He would take studio photographs. He would put people in poses. And Grandma Moses, in meeting him, they're actually in his studio, and he was talking about his process, and she says, "Oh, I could never do that." But of course, in a way, she was. It was different, and I think it's very, you know, one of the dangers of any parallelisms that you try to draw, which I do in my essay, is that just because something looks alike doesn't mean that it is alike. And I think as we move into the 21st century, and I think this relates to what Katherine said, I mean, time changes perspective. And so even though we've kind of have this kind of ingrained sense that art is about making something out of nothing, that as a whole is a myth. There's no artist makes something out of nothing. You're always drawing on the resources around you. You're looking, you're seeing, you're thinking, you're feeling, and you bring all of that in. And Moses just used these images as a tool. They were part of her creative process. And so I don't know if that answers or adds more to the conversation, but I just think, you know, with a 21st century perspective, we can look back and look at process, the sort of things that people tried to hide in the mid-20th century, Moses and others alike, and say, process is just as important as the finished product in some ways. It adds a layer or layers of meaning when you start to dissect an artwork in its meanings, which the meanings that we apply to them today aren't necessarily the meanings that Grandma Moses intended, but that doesn't mean they're any less real or significant in our understanding of her work.
This is a little bit of tortured logic on my part, but I think the fact that she felt the need to deny the art secrets, that itself is kind of a modern, that's performing her, you know, her identity as a modern artist. Jamie and I were looking at some paintings by the artist J. Hall Conaway yesterday, who was on Monhegan and then moved to Vermont. And when he was on Monhegan off the coast of Maine, you know, he kind of billed himself as the successor to Winslow Homer. He arrived in the, you know, the 1920s after Homer died, 10 years after Homer died. And he repeatedly put it out there that he never worked from photographs. A number of years ago, I was looking at his papers at the Archives of American Art, and of course he had these strips of contact sheets of waves that he had cellophane taped into his day book. And then when I finally went and saw his house, it had a dark room right in the middle of it. So he was heavily invested in the latest technology of the 1920s and 30s. So I'm told.
Can you speak into the mic,
sir? Sure. I'm told that these microphones are actually strong enough to pick you up when you ask questions. So what we want to do is turn this around to you now to ask questions. Helene.
I'm trying to speak loudly enough. First of all, it's been a marvelous day, and thank you all very, very much. A constant one, I think, where the line between popularity and success merges with fine art. And I'm just thinking in terms of Norman Rockwell, we had an exhibit several years ago here with Warren Kimball, our own sort of local folk art. And I overheard, this was never said in the program, but I overheard someone who was attending said, well, of course he's just made $1 million on painting old barns. So there's that, my question really is the commercialism that can be damaging to art. And I think, Catherine, you referenced it when Europeans said it was much too commercial. I mean, when you have fabric painted with your art, it's not considered fine art. So how do we help the struggling artist who wants to sell a lot of greeting cards be accepted? How do we begin to merge the damaging line between commercialism and art appreciation? Is that clear, my question?
I think part of it is in how we tell the stories and how we honor these artists who straddle these different lines. And I was thinking last night in preparation for coming here about one of my mentors in grad school who specializes in the kind of invention of the art market in Europe in the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries, the way that auction houses and galleries kind of came out of the guild system and the artist studio system that originated, you know, in Italy and the Netherlands, et cetera. And his whole drive to do this, to study these market mechanisms that have existed throughout art history, has to do with his suspicion that, you know, what we know to be our canonical art history, including all of that great, you know, European art from the Renaissance and beyond, is what we know from the kind of, that's the highly vetted art. That's the art that was popular with, like, royal courts. That's the art that lived through the centuries, through these kind of highbrow tastemakers that created collections and institutions and really had the power to say, you know, Rubens, Rembrandt, these are the majors. But in fact, there were all these other market mechanisms operating where the public, the European public, was buying a very different kind of art from what we see in the art history books from these periods. And it's kind of similar when you think about you know, American art in any century, but we're talking about the 20th century right now, which is that there's always kind of different levels of support and interest happening. You know, there's what's going on in the museum world among the academics and the art critics and this sort of thing. And then there's what the public is doing. And the public is a greater or lesser force in the arts, especially in this country, depending on what decade you're in. I think Grandma Moses came on at a time when the American public had been deeply engaged in the arts in a way that it probably never had been before because of things like the Federal Art Project during the Depression and all of these attempts on the part of the government and other institutions to create infrastructures for people to buy affordable art and to learn about art through the radio and television and this sort of thing. And so my point really is just that there's always these different levels of taste, right, that are operating at any given moment. And of course, we have these dichotomies between high taste and low taste and this sort of thing. But what I would strive to do in the future, and I think what this museum, like Jane and I were just downstairs admiring, you know, the circus posters, for instance, and what's so incredible about this institution is that it has this incredible collection of material culture and, you know, other kinds of creativity and human production that don't fall necessarily in the fine art category, but were nonetheless like such important visual stimuli to artists and people in their daily lives. So I feel like that was a meandering answer, but what I'm trying to just say is that there's always different audiences for artists happening at any given moment, and the art history books tend to reflect only one side of that story. And part of opening up the story of Grandma Moses and helping people understand just what an important figure she really was in the 20th century, I mean, really the most famous American artist in the 20th century, is really empowering that kind of middle class and how important she was to that sphere.
This maybe touches on this. I often put things in quotes. When you're talking about self-taught art, folk art, there's a term that is often thrown around in the field of folk art and self-taught art, and that is discovery. Louis Calder discovered Grandma Moses at the Women's Exchange at the Thomas Drugstore in Hoosick Falls in 1938. Grandma Moses was painting for her family, her relatives, her friends, to make her home look better. She was convinced enough to show it at the Washington County Fair, though it didn't win any ribbons. Nobody seemed to be buying them out of the Women's Exchange. And so I think this relates to what Katherine was saying about kind of levels or I just want to be careful with that. That creates a sense of hierarchy. There are art worlds. And they operate on all sorts of different levels. And so Moses was creating within a very specific context before her work was shown at MoMA. You know, when I'm giving tours of our Grandma Moses gallery in Bennington and trying to help people wrap their mind around Moses, who she was as an artist, I say she went from the Women's Exchange in Hoosick Falls to MoMA in the course of 1 year. And those are two different worlds. And so it was being made and received in a particular world, and then it went into an art world, and it was received, and then the paintings became very, very popular with a public for lots of reasons, which we've discussed today. And they were put onto dishes, they were put onto fabrics for curtains and things like that, because people wanted that art in their home. They couldn't necessarily afford an original Grandma Moses, but they wanted to surround themselves with those things. That's a whole nother art world. It may be the same images, Grandma Moses' images. You know, you put a painting on a wall in a museum, you take a photograph of that painting and you print it on fabric and you put it in your wall. It's the idea that there are different structures and frameworks in which art and visual culture is received. And Moses's work crossed over those structures in a way that helps us understand them better, I think.
I think also one of the themes we've been addressing today and one of the themes that's central to this exhibition is the different myths and false narratives that have been built up over time around the concept of modernism. And one of them is this idea of insider and outsider. But another thing to remember, if you go back to the birth of modernism in Europe in the late 19th and early 20th century, it was very much a reaction on the part of many of these artists against the bourgeoisie and against the emergent capitalist marketplace. And the idea of art for art's sake, which then reemerges in the theories of Clement Greenberg that underlie the advent of abstract expressionism, are the idea that we are going to keep art pure and that, of course, artists don't care at all about money. The poster child for this is the communist Pablo Picasso, who was probably the richest and most successful artist of the 20th century. There's something wrong with this picture, but the errors in judgment are only beginning to be explored and unearthed. So the fact that Grandma Moses was being marketed commercially became almost instantly controversial. And it was something that, I mean, my grandfather was almost himself a little naive about it. He said, "Why? You know, what's wrong with this? Not everybody can afford an original Grandma Moses painting, and why shouldn't they have a reproduction suitable for framing or a drapery fabric or whatever, and enjoy living with these images that make people so happy?" And in part, as a reaction to the criticism that we received almost immediately, the company that my grandfather established to oversee the licensing Grandma Moses' properties was very, very, very strict in terms of its restrictions. You couldn't show a detail of a painting unless you showed the full thing, so that, in other words, she wasn't going to be misconstrued as an illustrator. Everything was going to be tied back into the full image. And in terms of licensing for advertising or products, it couldn't be a product that she herself wouldn't have used. So there, the limitations that we impose, and to some extent still impose on what we license, are so sweet, so endearing compared to what you see if you go into the Metropolitan Museum gift shop today, or the gift shop of any major museum. And this separation, you know, sort of between the dirty world of commerce and the high spiritual world of art, has been breached in the interim in so many different respects, in so many different ways, that it becomes almost moot. And of course, today the art world is so obsessed with money, and the prices have become so ludicrously high that in turn raises a whole new set of problems. But I don't know. This could go on and on. I'm going to stop it there.
Angelica.
This may be naive of me, but is it possible to buy any of her china, any pieces of her china?
On eBay.
I just want one.
From all the different things that you've been saying, you know, it seems to me now, what is it? Is it art? Is it this? What is it? Nowadays, in the 21st century, we're sort of left to decide for ourselves. I mean, I can put up any image of Grandma Moses or anybody on my computer screen and enjoy it in my office or whatever all the time. But taking it to like the personal thing, with what Katherine talked about how her art was used out in the world to, you know, during the Cold War, here's America. It also seems that accessible art, like Grandma Moses, there becomes an element of personal ownership that people seem to take. You know, this is their artist, this is, I'm not sure exactly what I'm saying here, but it seems that that had a big effect on what people thought it was, what kind of art this was, but this very personal thing where, you know, viewers were invited to finish the story in a way, they're invited to step inside and now they're there and they own it. So I guess I'd like you to speak on, not on the broader scale, but more how the personal effect has then affected the bigger scale, if that makes sense.
There is a painting by Grandma Moses called, I think it's My Homeland or Homeland or My Country, I'm not remembering the exact title, but it's this image of a beautiful golden field, I think a road in the foreground, and it's this idea that, and it looks very much like the rolling hillside of upstate New York where she lived and worked and farmed for much of her life, and it turns out it's based almost directly on a reproduction of a farm in Maryland. It's this idea that Grandma Moses was, I think this is the thing that, for me, again, really makes her work function on the level that it does and why it's so personal, is that it was both personal, but it was oftentimes based on these images that were the popular culture of the period that people saw and kind of unconsciously or consciously kind of absorbed into themselves. And so while it's personal, it's Moses's life, it's Moses's world, unconsciously it's also the world that they live in, and it's their world as well. So her work bridges the idea of the kind of personal creative pursuit of the modern artist with the larger idea of it's accessible because she's using these visual tropes of kind of the romanticized image of rural America to connect with a larger public who is absorbing kind of these images on a daily basis, and it becomes a part of who they are too.
Yeah, and I would add to that that there is this amazing universality. You say it looks like New York State. In fact, it's Maryland. And you can take it to Japan. And for the Japanese, it could be their own landscape. And I think that's rooted in an experience of the natural environment that we all share. There is really something universal in these works.
Yeah, and there's a book that was published on Grandma Moses about a decade ago by Carolyn Marlene, and I think it's in her introduction. She does this beautiful vignette about how seeing a Grandma Moses to her is like flying in an airplane over a landscape. And when I read that, it was so right on, because I was on the air last night, and when I'm in the window seat admiring the landscape below, that beautiful quilted patchwork, you know, whether it's of lights at night or of landscapes during the day, that's a visual image that has always really affected me very emotionally, I think. Maybe I'm an emotional flyer. Because you're flying over these landscapes and you see something that looks so beautiful, it's so perfected from a distance, and yet so familiar because like Jane was saying, I mean, these landscapes, when they're abstracted in this way, they all look the same. And you also, I think, feel an intense desire. So Carol Ann kind of, she sketched that out beautifully. And then what I would add to that is that you feel this, intense desire to be in it at the same time. And this goes to what I was bringing up about Jane's thinking of this as a paper doll world and using these figures as avatars. So that's, to me, what the kind of push and pull of Grandma Moses' work that makes it so personal to me and kind of emotional is like there's this, pushing away from the landscape that allows you to see it at this perfected distance as though from the air, and it's a generalized, universal landscape. And then there's this kind of pulling in through these figures where you get to kind of play out this fantasy that I always have in the air of just kind of parachuting down and becoming part, you know, of that gorgeous landscape that I'm viewing from the sky. And of course, the sad kind of thing is that you can't have both, right? In reality, the moment you parachute down from your airplane, you become part of what that landscape is really like, which is probably nowhere near as perfect as it looks from a distance. But in Grandma Moses's paintings, you do have both. You know, you get to have that that kind of perfection, both far away and up close. And I that's something that has always really resonated with me as a viewer.
I'm going to put an oar in the water on this too. We decided not to inflict my essay on you as a talk today. But it has a lot to do with that notion of the persistence of sentiment into the modern era. And picking up exactly on what Katie was just saying, it has a lot to do with how Grandma Moses' paintings create what I was calling an operating system for the new suburban landscape after World War II. So if you think about the United States, 1944, 1945, it's sort of obvious the war will be over soon. The series of sort of questions that appear in popular magazines, you know, how will we house this nation after the war and this expanded nation? There are a series of these architectural competitions. Life magazine, the Loose magazines, all, you know, would do this sort of annually. And it became kind of a little game because they would pit, you know, Frank Lloyd Wright versus a colonial revival architect for, you know, what will America look like in 10 years? The little cape? Or a machine for living? And of course, the answer is always the little cape. You know, for every house that was designed with a butterfly roof, you know, a modernist house, there are tens of thousands of little gambrels and capes and garrisons built in this country. And I think what's so powerful about Grandma Moses' paintings through these art secrets is the way that she was encoding, you know, that sort of human scale need for those small houses in her paintings, which explain this shift from the city out to suburbia, which is, of course, the landscape that so many of us were familiar with. It's not that far from Cambridge to Levittown, Long Island, is the idea. Ducky?
Perhaps after the war, during that time, people were seeking an innocence.
Oh, for sure.
And her painting personifies pure innocence. And when you look at it, it makes you think of, oh, look how wonderful things were, even though we didn't have all the wonderful things we have now. And I was thinking, she had a way of being creative very cleverly by using other people's creativity. So she was able to combine their creativity with her creativity and come up with this wonderful work that kind of hooked people.
The historian and critic and American studies scholar Leo Marx had this little throwaway statement that, you know, every generation likes to think ours lost its innocence. You know, ours was the one where somehow it all went wrong and escaped, but in fact, it was this era when things got profoundly frightening. You know, their parents were maybe afraid of moving to a city or traveling 60 miles an hour on a plane, but by 1945, the world can end in a minute. So this need for this kind of emotional, you know, succor is huge.
I referenced the Promised Land at the very end of my talk. And Jane mentioned, showed a painting which is currently on view at the Bennington Museum, Mount Nebo in Winter, and is quickly becoming one of my favorite Grandma Moses paintings. Mount Nebo, as Jane said, it's the mountain from which Moses ascended, and of course he was going to see the Promised Land. It's this trans-historical connection. But I think I think of Grandma Moses paintings. She was painting the Promised Land for mid-20th century America. There really, as Tom said, there was this need for the golden era that never really existed, of course. It existed in some ways, but of course it's also a sort of manufactured nostalgia. She was taking what she wanted, what she had lived, and she was giving it to the people. She wrote in a beautiful letter to Hildegard Backert, who's the co-director of the Galerie St. Etienne, who kind of got to know Grandma Moses as well as anybody while she was living and working. And it was written in 1944, I think, at the height of the war. And she talks about the war and how the world, but there will always be hope for the future. I mean, she was very conscious. She wasn't, you know, again, she wasn't disconnected from what was happening in the world. She was aware of it, and she was making a choice to look to the future for hope. You know, as Jane said, you know, hope was kind of one of the things that really grounded it. It would be her mantra. It's this idea of creating something that Americans could, and Europeans for that matter, as Katie's talk made clear, could hold on to in this era of turbulence and et cetera, et cetera. So.
I just have a comment, Tom, because I worked here from 2000 at the museum, from 2001 to 2006 as a guide on the grounds, and people would always come in and say, "Where are the Grandma Moses?" And I would have to tell them that they were in Bennington. And you've made it happen, so thank you. Not as many as you have in Bennington, but it's a wonderful celebration because there was an outcry, you know, 15 years ago for Grandma Moses at Shelburne Museum.
Thank you. And this is, you know, we're very self-conscious about reintroducing the American Paintings Collection at Shelburne Museum. This was something, as soon as we finished this building, the Pizzagalli building, in the summer of 13, we began rehabilitating the Webb Gallery, our paintings gallery. We had a consulting conservator working on that collection. And in a little, you know, sort of synecdoche of this larger conversation, Electra Webb began collecting American paintings in 1957, coincidentally, shortly after she was given that Grandma Moses painting. She purchased some quote-unquote folk paintings from, using Jamie's quote-unquote, from the downtown gallery before, but she really began in earnest in 57. By 59 and 60, she'd acquired several hundred paintings. And then right at the end of her life, she begins collecting Georgia O'Keeffe, Charles Sheeler, Yasuo Kuniyoshi, William Zorak. A number of you have heard this story. And for a woman who is so ecumenical in her interests here, with 100 and some odd thousand objects and a steamship and all this, it was interesting to read her letters and see how she struggled with the categories that we've all been talking about for the last day and then also, you know, the last couple of years with Jamie and myself. She called the modern collection the new collection, and the paintings she had divided into academic and primitive. The lists that she kept herself were academic and primitive and then the new collection. And that's all right in the same period we're talking about here, 57 to 60, 61. And very reminiscent of everything that Jamie was talking about that was going on, you know, at MoMA and in New York art worlds, and I like the pluralization there.
Yeah, I was just going to add that survey that I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, They Taught Themselves, that Sydney Janis put together. I always reference in the essay, the introductory essay for that, he kind of goes through all of the different ways to refer to these artists. And this is 1942, and he's like, well, we can call them Sunday painters, we can call them naive painters, modern primitives, you know, self-taught artists. And it's all, and he goes through each kind of classification and explains why it doesn't work, essentially. And then kind of lands with self-taught as being the least offensive. And that's kind of where we are still, like 80 years later almost, is that we can't come up with a good way to classify these artists. Everything's, even self-taught doesn't quite work because it's kind of too big of an umbrella, and many of these artists were learning from, you know, not necessarily just themselves, but their communities or other artists. They didn't go to art school, so in that sense, they were self-taught, but they weren't really, it wasn't all completely internal. In fact, most of it wasn't internal, as we've seen from someone like Grandma Moses, who's using all these popular sources. So the point is that this kind of discomfort with labels and classifications and how do we get past you know, these kind of compartmentalized histories is something that is so persistent. Just decades and now almost a century, we haven't quite figured it out. And I don't know that we will. And
we trip over it all the time.
Yeah.
Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where I lived for a little while, there was Sam the Dot Man, who was the official outsider artist of Winston-Salem. So he's the official outsider artist of Winston-Salem, who promoted every year that he went up to the Smithsonian Folkways Festival on the Mall. So it was, you know, he would sort of bring you, you know, bring you to this moment of outsiderness. By way of, you know, the official stamp of the city of Winston-Salem and the federal government.
Well, you know, in terms of outsider and insider, my take on that is that obviously there are always going to be artists who are overlooked or forgotten. Whatever mechanisms we have in place for anointing greatness are not foolproof. But putting that aside, to me, the idea of this unwieldy category without a suitable name is that it is really an artifact of modernism and of a certain modernist narrative that codified a mainstream. And any artists working within the same general geographic and temporal locations who were not part of that mainstream, by circumstance, by their own choice, by the choice of the arbiters of taste, fall into this category of the other. But I don't think that narrative and those boundaries that once seemed so fixed really obtain anymore. So we have a much more open-ended art world that in fact for the first time truly is an art world because it's global and we take into account so many more traditions, whether they're of non-white people, people of color, women who were once largely excluded, and non-American nationalities, traditions other than Western European. I mean, there are just so many different types of art out there that we now have to absorb and make sense of, that this idea of the outsider is irrelevant today, I think, largely irrelevant.
I wonder to what extent, you know, the rise and fall, I guess, of criticism has played in this. If you think about, you know, the Rotary Press of the 1830s and 40s, which puts multiple newspapers in every city, and you have multiple critics who are sort of fighting over this idea of fine art by the late 19th century in urban centers around the world. You get artists who are very good at manipulating the critics from the, you know, late 19th century through the period we're talking about. And today, anyone can say anything.
Yeah, well, and of course, the whole Instagram aesthetic has its own problems, multiple problems, I think. And they're problems that also get into the way art is marketed today. So it's not like we're going from this benighted era of the closed-minded Clement Greenberg into some kind of brave new world of the internet. It's just that the issues are changing.
We don't really have Clement Greenberg
today. No, we don't.
Yeah.
No.
And I'm trying to think of, you know, we have certainly marquee critics in New York.
But they don't wield that kind of influence.
They don't wield that kind of authority. And when you get into, you know, the provinces of Boston, to say nothing of Burlington, you know, Boston has been a one-critic town for years and years and years. They have a very smart one right now, but for years and years, you get sort of one voice. So that whole, your moment, a few minutes ago, where you're talking about the sorting, how people get left out, they get left out through that process.
But I think also that the point of view of the museum community and the scholarly community has changed. You know, you do have a kind of collusion, witting or unwittingly, between Greenberg and Alfred Barr, where the codification that he was attempting in the chart that Jamie showed us, what was, you know, I mean, definitely an attempt to establish very firm rules. And I don't think, I think one of the problems for people in the academic community today is that there are no rules. You know, it's very interesting to go in depth into one artist's context and sources and reception, but how do you put it all together? How do you make sense of it without a narrative? That's the new problem.
And I think that increasingly you're seeing museums develop more incorporative visions for artists like Grandma Moses, and so I'm going to segue into the exhibition tour for you.
I think we should.
No, but I wanted to plug that I didn't get a chance to play one of my exhibitions yet today, so I can't miss this opportunity. But we're opening in February a large show, 200 plus objects, called The Power of Place, Cross Country, The Power of Place in American Art. And it's all about the way that American artists took on landscape and the kind of like small town America subject matter as an important force in modernism after 1915. And we're putting, thanks to the Galerie St. Etienne, a beautiful early Moses Sugaring Off painting in the show, and we're incorporating, in fact, a lot of self-taught artists into the exhibition. So we're putting, you know, Moses alongside O'Keeffe and, you know, all of the kind of big names of that period. We're also including photographers who often get left out of this modernist narrative, but were, in fact, really feeding on the American landscape at the same time that American painters were. So it's going to be a great show. If any of you are in the region or want to make a special trip, I invite you to come down. But I think I saw this as a segue because I think it's, you know, what Jamie and Tom have done with this show, which is so unique, you know, is bringing in these kind of iconic figures of post-war modernism and showing you these kind of linkages. And that's something that's really exciting that we'll enjoy seeing, and that's happening more and more in museums. So that will hopefully help to break down some of these barriers.
And we learned today there is a direct flight from Burlington to Atlanta.
Yeah. Yes, that's right.
I would like to thank our panelists again. I would like to thank all of you so much. Karen Peterson and her staff from the Education Department.